be ready to stand trial anywhere where I think I can have a fair trial.
Carlos Ghosn was a leader almost like no other in the auto industry.
He was a superstar. He could get access to Putin.
This is a guy that is a definition of ambition.
He's very charismatic, globe-trotting CEO.
Then when he was arrested, everything changed.
Everyone's interested in the Carlos Ghosn story.
The story of power, it's almost a story of megalomania.
He had really lost his mind.
It's got high stakes escape, money and betrayal.
Carlos Ghosn has very much a melting pot heritage.
His grandparents are Lebanese, they moved to Brazil.
He was born in Brazil, he moved to Lebanon when he was very young. He was then educated in Lebanon.
Carlos left Lebanon to study engineering in France.
In Paris at one of the Grand Écoles.
He's part of a class of other similarly mathematically gifted guys. I mean, people he ended up working with, like Patrick Pallotta.
He had the reputation to party a lot.
He joined Michelin straight out of university.
And he made a name for himself there as a turnaround specialist.
He then got a job down in South America for Renault, where he also turned around their operations. He didn't see himself as tied to any one nation, even to any one region or continent. He was very much a man of the globe.
He never fit in the French establishment. That was bothering him.
Elite Paris is a very small club.
I don't know if they were rejecting him or he didn't want to join.
He would call himself a citizen of the world. Perhaps he struggled finding himself when he was at Polytechnique.
He definitely was outside of the real Parisian core elite. And I've talked to a lot of people around him who know him who say that that did drive him. He gets parachuted into Nissan after Renault rescued a really struggling Nissan.
Carlos Ghosn arrived at Nissan as chief operating officer in 1999, and 2 years later, he became the chief executive officer. People didn't know who he was. People were watching him with skepticism as a foreigner.
This mystery man, initially, he creates this turnaround.
He was very fast in compiling a recovery plan for Nissan, which is now famously called a Nissan Revival Plan.
That was what was the making of Carlos Ghosn as a businessman.
Ghosn, when he'd come into a corporate situation and needed to turn it round, was ferocious.
Cutting 21,000 jobs.
And this led to his name, Le Cost Killer.
He broke down the traditional network of close suppliers that are tied through cross-shareholdings.
He was not afraid to try to understand what the people were doing, pushing for potential improvements. At that time, he had a lot of empathy.
Nobody really expected the outsider to succeed.
It's probably one of the most successful corporate turnarounds in history.
That's when the superstardom really begins.
Ghosn, within 12 months, was clearly knocking it out of the park.
He can see the opportunity, and he grabbed it.
His face was on children's lunchboxes. He had his own comics.
It's really rare for a foreign CEO to be in a Japanese manga. It really brought him close to the Japanese people.
He was on TV regularly. The newspapers and magazines fell in love with him. He said, "We don't deliver this Nissan recovery plan. I and my board will resign." This was a big statement in Japan, and that made this manga hero.
It's difficult to overstate where Nissan sits in the Japanese perception. It's one of its great companies. And then you have Carlos Ghosn coming into that story as the savior. And Japan desperately wanted to get behind that story. Very ambitious guys are often very good for companies that need pretty powerful medicine. There was a big shortage of Japanese corporate leaders who were willing to be quite as direct about what needed to be done.
People liked him. You could send a letter in Lebanon with Carlos Ghosn's face on it. Carlos Ghosn could do no wrong.
He's extraordinarily motivating to work for. I wouldn't call him particularly friendly. He would address me as Andy. 14 years that I knew him, I still addressed him as Mr. Ghosn. In
2005, he took on the job as chief exec of Renault as well.
He traveled more often, this globe-trotting CEO.
Living and working in both France and Japan at the same time, or a week a month in Japan, a week a month in Renault.
Less time on the ground, more time in the air. He was doing a lot of public relations, communications, talking. He was a figurehead.
And as a result, his management style had to change.
Originally at Nissan, it was more like an operational role where he was really fixing the problems at Nissan, but he became more of a head of the lions.
The suits got better, more expensive, the haircut got better.
His geeky glasses were replaced. You could definitely see at this point Carlos Ghosn beginning to think the world was his and that he should be paid accordingly to that.
He was partly a creator of this image of the global CEO, private jets and the suits and so on.
This idea of Davos man, it's crude, but there's truth to it. He stopped being the kind of guy who was on all the details.
A presentation by managers of Renault to Carlos Ghosn is like the big event of their career, at least of the year. But little by little, I was seeing him on his smartphone, not for 10 seconds, which can happen, but for 1, 2 minutes, 3 minutes out of the meetings. I was ashamed of that.
You're dealing with a monster of a company across two different cultures, huge distances apart. Can somebody really manage that? The real life experiment of Carlos Ghosn suggests not.
I told him, your way of management does not work anymore.
He had to manage the French state. He had to manage Renault. He had to manage a Japanese culture.
He became stretched. You lose touch of reality. He was seen as being more remote, not having the time necessary to take care of Nissan.
After Nissan's revival, Nissan became a much more powerful company. Is this really an equal alliance when one has a voting stake and the other has a non-voting stake? There was a whole question about the skewed capital relationship, Renault holding a 43% stake in Nissan, while Nissan only held a 15% stake.
The alliance was dysfunctional from the day it was created.
In 2016, Nissan takes a large stake in Mitsubishi.
It was really a Carlos Ghosn moment when he struck this alliance and brought in Mitsubishi.
Carlos Ghosn moves over to become the company's chairman.
One of the benchmarks for the automotive industry was 10 million vehicles per year that Toyota or Volkswagen sold.
This was a long-time obsession of Carlos Ghosn's.
Adding Mitsubishi was a key part of his vision.
Carlos Ghosn was obsessed with scale.
He wants it to be huge.
Not just on a level with Toyota and Volkswagen, but untouchable as the biggest car maker in the world. He wanted to merge with Fiat Chrysler. This would take them from 10 million a year up to 14 or even 15 million a year. They would be the industry behemoth.
There was a certain amount of ego, wanting to be the biggest car company in the world.
Ghosn was obsessed with being the biggest and the best. That became an issue.
Some people said those pressures have actually led to some of the financial struggles that the companies are facing now.
Volume is not a goal. Volume is a result of good management. It was bad deals just to add volumes. So this is not the Ghosn I had known.
Fiat may well have worked as a deal, but there were still big questions about integration, particularly when Renault and Nissan themselves are so far apart on so many issues. But it was right after that that it all came crumbling down.
There have been a handful of foreign CEOs of Japanese companies. They earn less than their counterparts in the same industry elsewhere in the world.
Carlos Ghosn always felt irked that he had ended up working in two countries where high pay was a toxic subject.
He always used to say that compare it with the pay package that rival CEOs get, then it wasn't like he was getting overpaid.
And there was always a fear that if he didn't get paid enough, he'd just leave. And that led to efforts to try and find other ways of compensating him that actually are at the heart of the allegations he faces now.
For successful leaders, sometimes the lines do blur between what's personal and what's business.
He's in charge of this alliance, but which wallet is this coming out of? Which wallet's this coming out of?
There was a cloudy afternoon in November 2018 when Carlos Ghosn's private jet had just landed in Tokyo. And this was the moment for him that it all fell apart.
I remember checking on my mobile and having a news alert saying Ghosn was arrested. I thought it might be wrong. How could this happen?
Agents boarded the plane and Ghosn in the airport was arrested.
It's a pretty dramatic way of going on the offensive to replace your CEO. Normally you get a brown envelope.
The real question from Carlos Ghosn is how big would that brown envelope have had to be?
There was a feeling at the time that this was some kind of inside job, that Nissan wanted him out, and this was one of the reasons that, you know, a national company like this would suddenly decide to pursue him for things that they said he'd been doing for years. Why did this happen now? Had Ghosn been betrayed by somebody inside his own camp?
It was completely sudden. and completely free of build-up or anything.
If he had any inkling this was coming, he would not have got on that plane.
Is it a plot, or is it that there was a fundamental problem with what was happening at Nissan and somebody blew a whistle on it?
Yeah, because the truth is about the money. The truth is not about intentions that you think people had. He betrayed Nissan, yes. He betrayed the people of Renault and Nissan by not doing his job. This is the worst of the worst.
There were multiple instances of him using the Nissan corporate jet, which had Nissan as the tail number, for personal and family trips. He saw it as his right as the top of these companies, particularly if they couldn't pay him enough money, that he would be able to live off the businesses. A house provided in Lebanon, a house provided in Brazil, even though neither of them were major pillars for either companies. There were alleged payments to a dealership in Oman. Some of the money that went here was alleged to have been used to have bought a private yacht.
He's been alleged to have diverted about $5 million of Nissan's money to companies that are related to his family.
It was the case of a lavish birthday party, which was hosted at the Palace of Versailles with a Marie Antoinette theme.
When he's saying that this was not for his birthday, but for the Alliance 30 years anniversary, this is a pure, pure lie. And this is a shame to say that. Yeah. Nobody from Nissan and Renault, past or present, went.
You have to be a little tone deaf to try and pull off a Marie Antoinette themed party at Versailles. I don't think anyone's watched that video now and hasn't like winced.
He had really completely lost his mind. Lost his mind. Something was broken. Something was broken.
The US Securities and Exchange Commission brought a fraud case against Ghosn. It alleged that he had hidden $140 million of pay at Nissan. Ghosn settled the fraud case. He paid $1 million. The Nissan launched a governance probe. This found what it described as a personality cult of Ghosn, where he could basically do what he wanted.
I mean, a lot of people were feeling his rule at these companies was a dictatorship. He was consolidating power.
He was feared. Some employees described him as autocratic.
Was he living on a reputation that latterly he no longer deserved as a manager?
He was planning to fully merge Nissan and Renault. And so that exposed the various tensions that have been building up to that 2018 arrest.
It is entirely possible that Carlos Ghosn, over the years, did find ways to squirrel away money that he thought he was owed. And at the same time, he also wanted to solidify the alliance and hand more power to the French, which was the thing that those inside Nissan were terrified of.
He was locked up for 108 days. He was questioned without a lawyer present. And then he was released on bail. So it was going back and forth between bail and rearrest.
Carlos Ghosn was under house arrest. He was under 24-hour surveillance. Every time he left the house, he was followed not by one, not by two, but by three different sets of tails.
At the end of 2019, news goes out that Ghosn has escaped.
I love the escape. I think it's the best bit of the story. The whole thing is absurd from start to finish.
An email landed from our correspondent in Beirut, who said, Carlos Ghosn has just arrived. And I had to do a double take.
How is Carlos Ghosn in Lebanon? Like, this doesn't make any sense.
Especially because of this 24-hour surveillance.
We didn't know that he was planning an escape, that he was trying to come back to Lebanon. He managed to evade detection by the guards who were supposed to be watching his house. He met his fellow conspirators at a hotel in Tokyo. Carlos even rode a bullet train at one point.
Wearing a mask, even though this was before the pandemic, he was still in a country where lots of people wore masks for public health anyway.
He was smuggled out of the hotel in a box for audio equipment.
So he's able to go inside it, there are air holes drilled in it. In a private jet, you can get access to the hold quite easily. When the doors are closed, and as the champagne is being served, Carlos Ghosn comes out of his box and comes into his private jet, a free man.
I didn't really believe it. You could only be taken back by just how audacious that escape had been.
Unbelievable how he managed to do it, you know, without the Japanese police or any of the prosecutors actually finding out.
The escape flight was from Japan to Turkey on the grounds that if they flew directly from Japan to Lebanon, it would have raised too many suspicions.
He flies the relatively short journey from Istanbul to Beirut, disembarks in Lebanon. starts his new life as a man on the run. Lebanon doesn't have an extradition treaty with Japan, so this was one of the reasons why it was a destination of choice for him.
So long as he stays in Lebanon for now, he's safe.
My favourite bit about the escape is just simply imagining Carlos Ghosn before all of this, imagining his future where he has to climb into a box with air holes to try and escape through an airport. It's just fantastically absurd.
Yet another part of a story that was never going to end with any kind of normal or predictable outcome.
Sitting here today, I almost think it had to end that way. You had to have a green beret mercenary scoping out airports to help him escape.
Mike Taylor, he's a guy with a long history with Lebanon, deep, deep ties in the country and in the region.
You had to have fees paid in Bitcoin, and you had to have WhatsApp chats and accounts set up by his sister or something. It's just fantastic. It had to end that way.
It shows actually a level of desperation. Carlos Ghosn was convinced and has always said he didn't believe he would get a fair trial in Japan.
Carlos's opinion was he had been stitched up, that he was going to be convicted no matter what.
He never thought that Japan's justice system was fair, and so he would never receive a fair trial in Japan.
If you believe Ghosn, his downfall was a result of a plot by people within Nissan who wanted him out, in part because of his plans to bring the alliance closer together.
And he said, I wasn't escaping justice, which of course is exactly how it's cast in the Japanese media. He says, you know, I was escaping injustice.
I'm going to fight because I have to clear my name, and this is something which is extremely important to me.
The press conference in January last year was a sensational exhibition.
He gives this press conference in four languages.
Nos amis de la presse française.
English, Arabic, French, and Portuguese.
He stood at the front of this hall and had projected on the screen behind him large print documents with highlighted bits and circled bits that he claimed prove his innocence.
No one could really tell what they were about. I mean, he was going through them all so fast. It was almost impossible to know what was going on, all of these slides that were flashing before our eyes.
He said those documents would then be available to the media afterwards. By and large, they have not been.
Who was part of the plot?
He intimated that Japanese politicians and at the highest level there had been a conspiracy against him. And I remember sharing notes with a very experienced foreign correspondent afterwards, and he couldn't remember seeing a press conference this strange since he was in North Korea. After Carlos arrived in Lebanon, it had its year from hell. The economic crisis started to hit. All the money was stuck in the banks. The economy shrank by a fifth.
I'm sure that being confined to a relatively small country like Lebanon is going to feel like prison.
For this man to end up in a country that is on its knees is quite an extraordinary turn of events.
This is a man who had the world at his fingertips, who could go anywhere he wanted at the drop of a hat.
I think he's trapped now. I think he's trapped.
Everyone would have been watching to see whether that trial would have been done in a fair manner. That was really his opportunity to make his case. That opportunity has been forever lost.
He's definitely been busy. He popped up on Instagram holding a puppy aloft, doing a promotional post for this dog breeding company. He's also been working on a book. He launched a university business management course. It was going to cost anywhere from $15,000 to $20,000. For students to sit on this course. No one can get their money out of the bank. So it begs the question, like, who actually sat this course?
If you were to make a list of the auto execs who had shaped the modern automotive world, Carlos Ghosn would be either at the top or very close to the top.
Mr. Ghosn, you see, I still call him Mr. Ghosn. He had a gift for inspiring people.
Carlos Ghosn worked as that glue that tied together two different companies.
It's obviously sad to see a man that can go to greatness to something that bad, but the saddest of all is the two companies are still suffering from it.
The performance of the group, both Renault and Nissan, post the departure of Ghosn is pretty tragic.
So he let yes men or yes women around him. Ah, so shocking, so shocking.
That's a proof in one way that Ghosn was a linchpin in making it work, but he wasn't able to set that legacy in stone.
Does that alliance have a long and prosperous life without Carlos Ghosn?
Can it hold together? It's a tough call.
Both Nissan and Renault say in the future they will be smaller, but they will be more profitable than they are today. Carlos Ghosn's view of global scale being dominant is not something that survived his downfall.
Carlos Ghosn's story is a real lightning rod for fears about a CEO king.
He was there for so long that he saw this alliance as his, and there wasn't enough people around him to say no.
A CEO who's running three companies should have immediately raised red flags.
You can't be the CEO of two companies at once.
The board has to be there to challenge the CEO. The board of Nissan was not a real board.
We've seen this time and again. When people become bigger than their companies, they end up doing things that ultimately lead to their downfall.
There's going to be a redefinition of what the global CEO means. That's going to be an era that's going to be defined by somebody that isn't Carlos Ghosn.
The parties in Versailles are the things that are going to be remembered, right? Because it's such an excruciating symbol of someone acting like a king.
Carlos Ghosn now is still an important figure in the world. I think he likes that. Eventually that will end and he'll be in Lebanon. And I don't know how he'll handle that.
People will start losing interest.
His legacy is damaged forever, hanging over your head that you're a man on the run. It's going to be tough.
That would really be a sad ending for someone who was a powerful figure in the automotive industry.
He's kind of won. He's not behind bars. He's stuck in Lebanon. He's lost his crown, but there's still a kingdom for him here.
That sort of image of a private jet disappearing with a box with a former CEO inside it, that's the credits rolling.